looks like.
Show me what democracy looks like.
This is what democracy looks like.
Today, the ability to vote in elections is seen as an ordinary right of citizenship. Yet for most of our country's history, voting was a privilege bestowed upon a very small percentage of the general population. Fortunately, over the past 200 years, our country has recognized the importance of extending the franchise to more people, and through changes in state and federal law, the right to vote has gradually been extended to most U.S. adults. In this country, voting is the primary path to political agency. The fact that voters have the ability to kick elected officials out of office, out of power, gives voters power. Their opinions matter, so determining who should be allowed to cast a ballot is a serious issue for both politicians as well as the population at large. August 26, 2020, marks the 100th anniversary of the day all U.S. women won the right to vote. At the time, it was a close question, decided by the ballot cast by one freshman representative in the Tennessee State House. The women's movement had spent decades building support for the enfranchisement of women, and in 1920, they succeeded by the skin of their teeth. Until the ratification of the 15th Amendment, the question of who was entitled to vote was very much a matter of state law. Before the 19th Amendment was passed, proponents of women's suffrage were divided on the tactical question of how best to achieve the right to vote for women. Because voting rights are intrinsically a state law matter, many suffragists focused on changing state laws and constitutions. Others saw how the 15th Amendment changed the law throughout the country in one fell swoop and focused their advocacy at the federal level. During the early 20th century, women made strides on both of these fronts, with 20 states and territories granting women at least some voting rights before 1920. My home state, New Jersey, was not one of them. New Jersey women only regained the right to vote with the passage of the 19th Amendment. Yes, I said regained. From 1776 until 1807, some New Jersey women did have the right to vote. In the days of the early republic, it was common for voting rights to be limited to white men who owned a certain amount of real property and had a certain religion. Indeed, states like New Jersey that allowed people to vote if they could prove a net worth of at least 50 pounds in wealth, whether in land or in goods, were considered rather progressive, since New Jersey law did not require a resident to own land to be able to participate in our democracy. But New Jersey was even more progressive, because the New Jersey Constitution did not limit the franchise to white men. The state constitution afforded the right to vote to anyone, female, African American, foreigner, anyone who had resided in the state for at least 1 year and owned at least 50 pounds of wealth. Of course, married women couldn't own property. They were considered property of their husbands themselves, so this law only affected widowed or unmarried women. But for 31 years in New Jersey, many women could and did vote. What's fascinating about this story is the ease with which these women, along with non-white men and non-citizens, were disenfranchised in 1807. Why did it happen? During the lead-up to the 1808 presidential election, the Democratic-Republican Party dominated New Jersey politics, and Federalists were very much a minority voice in the State House. However, Republican President Jefferson's embargo policies were deeply unpopular with New Jersey voters, and the state Republicans were desperate to stave off a Federalist victory in the upcoming election. Unfortunately for party leadership, New Jersey Republicans were bitterly divided. From 1806 to 1807, the two wings of the party, the liberal majority and the moderate minority, disagreed on everything, including who was entitled to vote. All Republicans agreed that the right to vote distinguished free men from slaves, but while liberals believed that all people with a financial interest in the community were entitled to vote, moderates wanted the franchise limited, as it was in other states. State Republican infighting came to a head in 1807 over the location of a new courthouse in Essex County. Moderate New Jersey Republicans wanted the courthouse built in Elizabeth, while the liberals wanted it to stay in Newark. This fight escalated into accusations of voter fraud and near-violent bickering among state politicians. Party leadership was desperate to unify their fractured party before the 1808 election and sought to find a compromise to bring both wings together. They succeeded at the expense of New Jersey women. In the broker compromise, liberal Republicans backed the passage of a new state law that stripped the right to vote from women, along with black men and resident foreigners. In exchange, moderates agreed to keep the courthouse in Newark. While it may seem like New Jersey liberals traded away women's voting rights in order to save themselves the inconvenience of traveling an extra 6 miles to go to court, their agreement to the compromise may have stemmed from a tactical decision. You see, New Jersey women tended to vote Federalist, and the liberals might well have believed that by disenfranchising them, they would be helping the Republicans to victory in 1808. In 1807, no one believed that women were equal to men. That's why state legislators could so easily take away women's rights. But despite the widespread belief among prominent legal scholars of the day that the change was unlawful under New Jersey's state constitution, no one challenged it. Not even the women who had been active voters in the past. It's possible that they understood that until the cultural perception of women had changed, women would never be able to hold on to their rights. And in 1807, that change had not yet come. So women's participation in our democracy was erased, along with other groups also perceived as inferior, African Americans, foreigners, and poor people. Rights once gained can be lost without widespread support. While we are still battling these prejudices today, we've come a long way since 1807. The 1920 suffragists wove the morality of women's suffrage into the fabric of our culture so successfully that modern politicians would find it very difficult to take away our rights now, as they did in 1807. While there are still people today who don't really believe that men and women are equal, this view can no longer be openly expressed in polite company. Yet social change happens much more slowly and haltingly than changes in law. For any change to endure, both paper laws and a society's culture have to adapt. Broad changes in people's lives, like the movement for women's equality, require law and culture to move in a direction that supports the cause. We need political action, marches, rallies, lobbyists, voting, but we also need art, movies, TV shows, cartoons, and yes, even memes. Before the era of cinema, there were songs. Songs that could be shared through broadcast radio, and before that, through music halls and sheet music sold in dime stores. Music has always been a powerful force for change, both in the 19th century as well as today. Songs of the Suffragists examines the history of American feminism through lyrics, from the Bloomer's Complaint in 1851 all the way to Woman in 2017. These songs reflect the logic and the emotion behind the fight for equal rights. Everything old is new again as we trace feminist history through these songs and discover how the arguments and even symbols of the first suffragists are mirrored in the songs of their successors. The women's suffrage movement really got started in this country in the second half of the 1800s. Many of the radicals who formed the movement were first involved in the other major progressive causes of their day, abolitionism and temperance. These activist leaders took many of the arguments that had successfully won the support for the anti-slavery and anti-tavern causes and applied them to the women's suffrage movement. Back then as now, it's simply good marketing to take a winning tactic or slogan from one space and apply it to another. They didn't merely use the same organizing tactics other reformers used to seek changes in law, but also the same symbols and moral appeals to win people over. Legal rights have no real force until those rights are broadly accepted by the general population. This unfortunate truth is best exemplified in the way that the post-Civil War amendments were mooted through application of Jim Crow laws. Laws granting equal rights to marginalized groups have no basis unless they're enforced, and they won't be enforced unless the hearts and minds of the population are with them. The original suffragists fought for the legal right to vote not only by marching in political rallies, but also through songs, cartoons, and plays. From lobbying politicians to singing in the streets, suffragists sought to persuade people to join their cause. Radicals like Alice Paul, who endured hunger strikes, imprisonments, and force feedings. Lucy Stone, an abolitionist and suffragist who radically refused to take her husband's surname. Or Ida B. Wells, whose writings condemn both disenfranchisement and segregation, knew that if they were to win the right to vote as their first step in securing equal rights, they needed to persuade the ordinary population of housewives, widows, doctors, working men, that their cause was worth supporting. Winning hearts and minds is what culture wars are all about. And winning a culture war is even more important than winning a legal battle, given the lax enforcement of unpopular laws. Moreover, cultural changes influence politicians. Take gay rights as a recent example. Without popular TV shows like Will and Grace or Modern Family to help Americans accept the idea of gay relationships, it's unlikely that Lambda Legal would have been able to win their political crusade to make gay marriage legal. Well-known anti-slavery anthem, Battle Hymn of the Republic, was written by the suffragist Julia Ward Howe in 1861. Set to the popular anti-slavery music for John Brown's body, this song became a stirring cry to assert the superior morality of the abolitionist and union cause over the pro-slavery and secessionist side. The Christian imagery in its lyrics, from the Lord's Gospel, striking down the serpent, the judgment seat, and Christ's transforming presence, helped link the Union cause to God's cause, elevating people on the Union side to God's side. This song is still included in many Protestant hymnals today. Suffragists, who were often excluded from leadership roles in the abolitionist movement because of their gender, began their activist careers campaigning to free the slaves before joining the movement for women's rights. The arguments of the abolitionist movement can be found in the suffragists' songs and appeals, as they too asserted the moral superiority of their cause. The song, Dare You Do It, written by a well-regarded Kansas doctor, is set to the same tune as the battle hymn of the Republic.
Men who wronged their mothers and their wives and sisters too, how dare you rob companions who are always brave and true? How dare you make them servants who are all the world to you? Our truth is marching on.
This song explores the idea that without the franchise, women were made inferior, a concept which wasn't widely accepted as wrong back then and is still not fully accepted today. The imagery of freedom as integral to the fight for women's suffrage was a popular theme after the Civil War, and songs like Daughters of Freedom, The Ballot Be Yours, and Shall Women Vote linked the lack of suffrage to slavery.
Talk not of freedom, equal rights, cold-hearted selfishness, well in our land, around our hearts, dwell 20 million slaves.
As the women's suffrage movement was hitting its stride at the turn of the century, anti-suffragists reacted strongly to persuade the public against change.
Oh, have you seen Eliza Jane a-cycling in the park? Have you seen Eliza Jane? The people all remark. She shouts,
"Hi, hi!"
as she rides by, the little doggies bark. For we all have a pain when Eliza Jane goes cycling in the park.
Eliza Jane was a comedic song written by an anti-feminist in 1895. By titling his main character Eliza Jane, the author was leveraging one of the stock characters from minstrel shows popular in the 1800s. In those racist programs, Eliza Jane appeared as a woman who rejected her suitors. A woman who refuses a man's advances is sometimes labeled unfeminine, which is apropos to this song, where the author mocks and ridicules women fighting for equal rights as embarrassments who are masculine and ridiculous. While the music has been lost to history, the lyrics reflect the author's intent to lampoon women fighting for equal rights.
Eliza, dear, we sadly fear you have not started right. You will not see more liberty by being such a fright. Asylums yawn for you, my dear, and in the books we read how bloomers that too early bloom soon fade and go to seed.
Arguably, by naming the modern 20th century girl in his song Eliza Jane after the minstrel character, the lyricist may have also intended to link early feminists to African Americans, thus invoking the pervasive racism of the time to put down non-traditional women.
But as the 19th century drew to a close, people fighting for women's political equality focused their arguments in their songs on the matter of fairness. It was unfair that women, who were trusted with so much, with the raising of boys to men who could vote, were disenfranchised. Before radio and YouTube, the most effective way to get a musical message out was to add new lyrics to melodies that people were broadly familiar with. These song lyrics were published on broadsheets, often dedicated to famous suffragists. Set to the popular nursery song, Oh Dear, What Can the Matter Be?, the 1884 suffragist song of the same name focuses on all the work that women do that is equal to the work done by men, pointing out the unfairness of their lack of political power.
Oh dear, what can the matter be? Dear, dear, what can the matter be? Oh dear, what can the matter be? Women are wanting to vote. Oh dear, what can the matter be? Dear, dear, what can the matter be? Oh dear, what can the matter be? Why should men get every vote?
The 1914 song, How Can Such Things Be?, sung to the tune of Old Susanna, conflates voting with freedom.
Oh men voters, how can such things be? In all this free America, only one half can be free.
The song ends with the idea that failing to grant women suffrage is cheating, attempting to secure the vote like the New Jersey Republicans of 1807 by disenfranchising people instead of trying to win fair and square.
If I could run for president, I'd want a good clean fight. I'd want the women by my side, I'd grant their equal right.
But ultimately, women claim the right to vote on the basic notion that if a woman is rational enough to raise your sons, then surely she's rational enough to vote.
She's good enough to be your baby's mother, and she's good enough to vote with you.
These arguments of freedom, fairness, and motherhood also come into play in later feminist songs advocating for reproductive rights. How can a woman be free if the government takes control of her body by denying her health care? Arguably, the 1971 song The Pill by Loretta Lynn did more to normalize birth control in rural America than doctors and social activists of the day.
Yeah, I'm making it for all those years since I've got the pill.
Indeed, the debates that played out during the original suffrage movement can be found again in the fight to enact the Equal Rights Amendment in the 1970s and 80s. Phyllis Schlafly was not the first anti-feminist to use the theory that a woman doesn't need equal rights because she already has protection and even more influence on public life through her role as a wife and mother. That argument was also used by many anti-suffragist women in the 1900s, along with the claim that if women got the vote, they'd abandon their families. Suffragists countered by claiming it was unfair to ask women to take part in society by raising children and caring for the home while depriving them of a political voice. It's possible that the feminists of the 1970s veered too far from the culturally accepted traditional role of women as they sought to continue the march towards equal rights. Second-wave feminists may have lost the fight for the ERA, in part because they failed to leverage the rallying cries used by the original suffragists, who embraced their roles as wives and mothers to underscore the morality of their cause. Despite the efforts of anti-suffragists, the 19th Amendment was ratified in 1920, thanks in large part to a letter written by one mother to her 24-year-old son.
Dear son, hurrah and vote for suffrage, and don't keep them in doubt. Don't forget to be a good boy and help Mrs. Cat with her rats. Is she the one that put rat in ratification? No more from Mama at this time.
On August 18, 1920, Tennessee became the 36th state to ratify the amendment granting women the right to vote when Harry Byrne changed his mind and voted in favor of the amendment. He was called a traitor to manhood's honor. Byrne explained his last-minute defection from the anti-suffragist cause as follows.
I knew that a mother's advice is always safest for a boy to follow, and my mother wanted me to vote for ratification. Moreover, I realized this was an opportunity to free 17 million women from political slavery.
When women finally gained the right to vote, they took a crucial step towards equality, but the fight was far from over in 1920. The songs of later feminists underscore their efforts to win the right to own and control their own property, to receive equal pay for equal work, and most notably, to be free from domestic violence and sexual assault, an ongoing battle that has culminated in the Me Too movement of the 2010s. Recorded in 1966, Nina Simone's Four Women traces the history of African-American women throughout the years, capturing the subjugation, rape, and abuse heaped upon them.
My father was rich and white. He forced my mother late one night. So here I am. What do they call me? My name is Sophronia.
Almost every genre of popular music features iconic songs that highlight violence against women. From the 1923 blues hit by Bessie Smith,
I made sweet Papa song. He black my eyes, I couldn't see. Then he pawned the things he gave to me.
To the pop hit Summer Nights from the 1978 movie Grease. During the early 1990s, both the R&B group TLC as well as riot girl rock band Bikini Kill sang about how a man's story of rape and abuse will be believed over a woman's. The story form of country music lyrics often include abuse revenge narratives sung by women, including Dixie Chick's hit Goodbye Earl and Miranda Lambert's song Gunpowder and Lead from her double platinum album Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. Women had been singing about rape and domestic abuse for decades by the time Alyssa Milano's tweet kicked off the Me Too movement in 2017. Over the past few years, the women's movement has achieved real success in denormalizing rape and sexual abuse, because in 2020, having sex with an incapacitated woman is finally being viewed as socially unacceptable. This is a tremendous change from 1984, when the movie 16 Candles played this exact situation off as a joke in a PG rom-com. Social change, though painstakingly slow, has happened. In all, protest movements alone cannot change prevailing norms, nor can pop culture. But when combined, the two can become a powerful force to transform our society for the better. Protesters and activists can lead us towards change, but only when the general public is persuaded can the changes they champion endure. The idea that women should not vote seems almost inconceivable now, but 100 years ago that wasn't the case. It was through the combined efforts of activists and quiet supporters that women took a step towards full equality. Indeed, without the right to vote, women could never have gained the influence on politics or social culture that they have today. We are making great progress, but there is still much to do before we can achieve the equitable society that the suffragists first envisioned over a century ago. To continue our march towards full equality, we must use the mediums of our modern era, creating songs for YouTube and memes for text messaging, along with TV shows and movies. Only if we continue to write our new songs of suffrage will the concept of gender equality become so ingrained in our culture that, 100 years from today, people may likewise wonder how that notion could have ever been in doubt.
My name is Laura Engelhardt, and I'm one of the authors of Songs of the Suffragists, published by the League of Women Voters of Berkeley Heights, New Providence, and Summit. The League of Women Voters was founded by Carrie Chapman Catt in 1920, and local chapters like ours are still actively working today to support and educate voters. If you enjoyed this program, please consider contributing to our chapter. You can go to www.lwv.bhmps.org/get-involved. This program is based on our book, and if you haven't already read it, we encourage you to get it on Amazon. The book highlights many other interesting facts about American feminism and discusses songs not covered in this program. For more information about the League of Women Voters chapter in your area, please go to www.lwv.org.
But there's one of which we'll sing in this refrain. There are leagues both great and small, but the greatest one of all is the League of Women Voters we'll maintain. Why not come and join the League of Women Voters? They are gaining greater power every day. Ever striving for the right, never faltering